And welcome everyone to this virtual edition of Steampunk PowerPoint Karaoke. My name is Melissa Honig, and I am the lead organizer of the Watch City Steampunk Festival held in Waltham, Massachusetts. Steampunk PowerPoint Karaoke is an activity I've run live at other events such as Brass Ring Academy, Cogs Expo, and the Jewelry City Steampunk Festival. And I thought it would adapt well to this new world of virtual gatherings. Now, despite the word karaoke in the title, singing is not necessarily involved.
Aww.
An improvisational show in which my collection of very knowledgeable experts will each be giving a presentation based on a set of slides that I have prepared and which none of them has seen before. Let's see how they do. And now, I'm going to turn it over to our first presenter, Heather.
Hi, everybody. I'm Heather Rockwood. I'm the festival director for Jewelry City Steampunk Festival, which is going virtual this year with the help of the Steampunks of New England. Will be November 20th through 22nd, so watch us on Jewelry City Steampunk on Facebook, on Twitter, and on Instagram, and at jewelrycitysteampunk.com.
All right.
I will.
And Heather, your presentation topic that you chose was tea. Can you see the screen?
I can.
Then here we go.
Okay, welcome everybody to Planning the Perfect Tea Party, my favorite thing to do. Okay, so first of all, the most important thing is to make sure that you have fun guests, such as the person in the top corner that has his head under his arm, because that is super fun. And how could you not drink tea like that? And then you also have to have entertainment, like the people in the bottom middle, and also throw in a little bit of spicy with the two people on the bottom corners, because that's just interesting characters. And everybody in the very top just looks like they would be very fun to drink a cup of tea with. Now, when you choose a location, I mean, I'm not sure I would choose this location, but it's very important to choose a central location that everybody would be able to make it to. And I guess for them, this was it, in the middle of a crocodile-infested swamp. Now, when you consider the menu, you of course have to consider tea and pick out the best tea, as this gentleman in the top corner is doing, but also oysters, as we are in New England and we have lots of great seafood, but also this 1950s style of cookery on the other side, lots of jellies and meats and preserved items, it looks to me.
Oh,
now,
God.
Proper teacup handling. You should have a shelf, although I'm not sure this is the correct shelf for everybody's tea.
It is.
Dealing with uninvited guests. I'm not sure I would handle it exactly how they did in Pride and Prejudice and Zombies, but I would say that you should politely tell your guests that they are not welcome, whether it's with words or with knives. I'm not sure what style you would prefer.
Oh my.
Cleaning up is always very frustrating. There is spilled tea and crumpets everywhere. Make sure that you have the proper vacuuming procedure, as they do in this picture. Although my vacuum is much smaller and handheld, I think this is would actually be much more fun, although probably would take a lot more time. In conclusion, make sure that you have the best guests, the best entertainment, proper tea handling, a perfect location, great food, and that you plan to have a lot of fun activities at your tea party. Thank you for coming to my tea party talk.
I feel that last slide, it has to be captioned with one lump or two. Cream or sugar? No, thank you.
All right. Thank you very much, Heather. And our second presenter is Edward Von Arkham.
Hello, my lads and lovelies. Ladies and gentlemen and variants thereupon. Edward Von Arkham here, usually the town crier at the Watch City Steampunk Festival. Now back home in my hometown of Copper Steam City, doing a bit of fiddly bits. I have a presentation I want to talk to you about science. Yes.
Indeed. Can you see our presentation, sir?
Yes. Right. Yes. It's been a wonderful, wonderful year for science. As you can see here, we have this is an ongoing study of how long one can stare down the barrel of a microscope before one's neck starts to hurt. These specimens have been under observation for a good month now, and only the one on the far left, you see, the one who is no longer looking, has complained. As you can see, he's given up, and so far we have four. Three out of four have been able to make it over a month. Yes. Also, coming out of the patent office, we have new exciting ways this is a wonderful new patented machine on how to injure yourself very badly. Patent by Mr. W.E. Quinn, under the name Flying Machine, because we don't want to give away the game too easily. If we were going to call it the Self-Injury Machine, everyone would know what it was for, and they'd be pirating it left, right, center, and upside down. But as you can see here, you just strap yourselves into the pink bits. They actually are pink. That's not just for the diagram, but no, you strap yourselves into the pink bits. You find a very tall building, like the building up at the top left corner of the center. That's actually a building. It's actually orange in real life, the Scientific American building. And just jump off it, and you will you are guaranteed complete and total abrasion and rusions and multiple contusions and other things ending in oozions. But none so near spectacular as this next slide will show you. From the Department of Statistics, as you can see here, this is a correlative graph. Comparing the correlation, displaying the correlation between divorce rates in Maine and the per capita consumption of margarine. And this study was enacted to determine just how much free time members of our university have on their hands, and whether it is proving detrimental to the overall budget. So, you know, essentially we had a bit of money left over, we didn't know what to do with it, and if we weren't going to spend it, then we wouldn't get approved for the next budget next year. So this worked, and we were able to go up to Maine and find a lot of angry couples and shelves full of margarine. Anyway, in conclusion, we have too much time. Yes, biological observations. News, wonderful news that everyone who isn't me will not have heard of before. Ducks are mechanical. As you can see here, this is what a duck looks like from inside, at the top here, underneath the bill, which is operated by a hinge. Food is taken in through the funnel throat, down here, through the wisdom of what sits, round and round over the whirligigs, and then past here through the spark gap explodirator, and in through the tubular boodly burrs, and out through the piddle valve. Thank you. Yes. And now we have a new theory presented by Mr. R.W. Piddlesvik on the chameleon crustaceous. As you can see here, this is a photo taken from the menu of Josephine's All-American Eden Diner in Cattle's Punk, New Jersey. The theory is that health inspectors are too easily bribed, because that right there is not an Eggs Benedict. Yes, wonderful technological advancement. We here at the Institute have discovered that the addition of two great massive spoons on bendy sticks to the side of one's head can greatly increase the amount of stress and trauma to one's neck. But in order to countermand that, we've built this wonderful table. And here, demonstrating this wonderful advancement, is little Jimmy Walson Blake, who is known for his ability to hover several feet off the ground without putting any stress on his legs whatsoever. Yes, field observations here. We have some men that we have paid to stand in the field, and up there is our panopticon. We have been up here in the panopticon for a good several weeks, And the men have just continued staring at us, and we've continued staring at them. No one has blinked yet, but sooner rather than later, someone will, and the contest will be decided. Ah, yes. An update from the Australian office, the Australian Prime Minister here, has presented a wonderful, revolutionary new theory on the origins of humankind on planet Earth. The theory states that one day, about 3.5 billion years ago, a man by the name of Melvin Crump Plinkle, an inventor and misanthrope, arrived on the shores of the primordial ocean in his time machine and started kicking things that tried to crawl out of it. We are all descended from Jeff, the one that he missed. In conclusion, the Office of Monocular Observation has put forth a primary overreaching new ethos among to be followed by all men of science and women of science and ducks of science, that a man with one eye can see more than a man with two eyes, because the man with one eye can see the other man's two eyes, whereas the man with two eyes can only see the other man's one eye. Thank you.
Thank you. I'm sure that was very educational to somebody.
Very informative.
All right. Next up, our next presenter is Carrie.
Hello, everybody. My name is Carrie. I help out Melissa with the Watch City Steampunk Festival. And I've held a number of hats over the years, but oftentimes there's a certain degree of salesmanship that comes up as I serve as an ambassador for the festival. And as it just so happens, salesmanship is the topic of today's discussion. Because everything is on sale and you need to buy things now. And here's why. Buy now. Why aren't you buying? Buy it. Spinning towards commerce. Ah, yes, we see that the price has been reduced on this. Now, most people would consider it a deep diving suit, but that is just one of many things that this could be used for. For example, muffins. Have they ever come out of your oven and they are far too hot? Or you're working on a hot stovetop and there's soup and bacon grease and all sorts of manner of things. Why, just, you know, have your servants take the hour to get you into this surplus, war, Kraken-proof diving suit, and you're ready for culinary glory. Oh, and yes, here's a device that's literally flying off the shelves. Not the wings, actually, just that very dashing cap. It's a flat cap with its own goggles approved. I mean, what house doesn't have its own set of moth wings at this point? But that's the thing, with commerce creates new niches. People have moth wings, now they must have flat caps with goggles on them. Now they say two heads are better than one, but we all only have one head, but we can never have enough hats. More needs to be said. Ah. Don't forget your furry pals. Perhaps they need to repel an invasion from the Russian steppes, and you're not around to defend them. Make sure that your household is stocked with kitten-grade artillery. Ah, yes, here's an item that's a real gas. I think masks are terribly fashionable, and I think everybody will be wearing them in the future.
Really?
So useful. I mean, that's the thing about it. There's so little room to stable a horse in the modern metropolis that we're working on. So you still want to get your riding time and get to the practice before the yearly fox hunt. Of course you want the simulated horse. Ah, yes. be the first to, in your neighborhood to own these listening devices, because an important part of the modern consumer lifestyle is keeping up with the Joneses. But to know what, keep up with them, you must know what they're going to buy. If this can eavesdrop on conversations to know if they're going to have a new airship dock installed, a new mechanical horse simulator arrived. So by the time that they are just placing the order, you are already having the better version of what they were going to order delivered into your house. There you go, Dinkelberg!
Oh, dear Lord.
In conclusion, buy. You should be buying now. That's all the society is worth. You're a consumer. Your purpose is to buy. Go to a job so that you have money to go buy things. To pay rent or a mortgage, to have a place to store all the things that you bought. That's your purpose. I just saved you a philosophy degree. Your purpose in life is to buy things.
Thank you very much.
Did anyone notice that woman had hemmed her skirt with spoons?
I noticed the birdcage on her head.
I noticed the gal on the riding horse had a really cool undercut. Yeah.
And you make a good point. One can never have too many hats.
The photograph of that last photograph is like, that was actually like a form of advertising with women literally wearing the things that that they're advertising the sign and like walking advertisements back in the day. Yes. And in any case, actually, Russell is up next.
Yes, I am Russell Hanula, the Baron of Blueberry Hill. And I've been kind of trapped behind the veil lately. Still getting by.
And Russell will be presenting the award ceremony.
Oh. Oh no. Yes. Welcome to the Steampunk Awards Show. Yes. We have many, many categories and many winners. And I will do my best to make sure those goes to the right people. Let's. Oh, wait. Hold on. Wait. What happened?
We can't breathe.
Good news. We have unlimited minutes, thanks to the Time Travel Authority.
Excellent. Thank you.
Are we immortal now? If we have unlimited minutes, does that mean we're immortal?
Only if we stay here in the Zoom.
Well, I'm not leaving.
We have to stay in the Zoom zone. Anyway, on with the show.
Yes, awards. Yes. This is a very lovely awards. This is the how much can you drink awards, especially tea. And as you can see, this individual has drank everything in the building. So you know, even the things that she wasn't supposed to drink. So this might be her last photograph. But still, she won. She's very, very, very accomplished drinker. So thank you, Elise Aykroyd. Yes. This man won one of the Winter Games. Specifically, he had the most room left in his hat. They were able to get several basketballs in there. Of course, this is after they let them out. They couldn't actually keep them in there all the time. He wouldn't be able to walk around. But as you can see, he's done this for many years, and he's going to get going. I think he's still going places. We'll see. Oh yes, this is the Headless Valkyrie. Yes. This is highly prized, especially by our teachers. Our teachers deserve a Headless Valkyrie. All of them. And this is every teacher is going to be issued one of these because we feel they need that. Not funding, but this. They'll get this.
Oof.
Oh dear.
Ah, yes. This is the man trying to get to the award for moving a house with his head. I'm sorry to say he did not win. The one of the gentlemen behind him actually beat him like by about 12 feet. I don't know how. And I don't want to know how.
Oh no!
This is the
I'm so sorry. I don't know. I have any idea how that got in there.
I have no idea. These men are trying to win the Distinguished Key Award for the Murray G. Teat Award, and it's they're trying to get crushed ice through the teats, and the first one who could actually get it through, they're rarely way too into this award. As you can see, I don't know why.
Oh, no.
Oh, and finally, yes, this young man managed to catch himself an entire airplane. He was airplane fishing. He was just throwing a line up into the air, and he was able to catch one. The pilot was very, very put out, but he did catch the largest plane. Unfortunately, the first one who we thought was going to win, one Timmy Arbuckle, he did catch a 747, but it kind of went with him. So this one stayed though. So he was the other one was qualified, and this one was able to stay. So congratulations, you.
Thank you, and congratulations to all today's winners.
Melissa, what on earth were you Googling when you found the image of the men with the thing?
There's a Facebook page called Retronaut.
Oh, yeah, sure there is.
Great secrets, we understand.
Yeah. And our final presenter today is Daoud. Please introduce yourself.
Hello, I'm Daoud Alzair, founder of Curious Experience Design and loosely affiliated with Jewelry City. There we are.
There we are.
All right. Today, I'll be talking to you about the latest developments in steampunk fashions, especially when it comes to the do's and don'ts. For example, flying apparatus attached to you will invariably cause you to float off, so that's not a good place to start. But let's get to the meat and potatoes here. All right. So obviously, you spend a long day at a steampunk festival and you're going to want some snacks. But why carry them in a bag when you can accessorize? After all, as long as you can get your hands on some bronze-colored pretzels, you'll be off to a good start. You'll be off to the races. Also, bring a cake, just in case. And steampunk, of course, has a reputation for being very hot clothing. But if you're going to a summer steampunk festival, make sure to dress lightly. Just make sure, whatever you do, the most important things to wear are a top hat and a necklace of some sort tied to another person. Yes? All right. And make sure to wear a belt of some sort to keep the breeches up. If you're going with a group, why not coordinate? This way, if you approach any kind of raving lions or anything, you can confuse them with this razzle dazzle pattern by grouping together tightly. It works for gazelles. It works for you too. And of course, we come to the hats. Now, when choosing a hat for a steampunk festival, you don't want anything too understated or overstated. You have to find something in the middle. So it's best to make your way to a haberdasher who can really walk you through this, because hats are not to be taken lightly. You have to pick one out very carefully. Mm-hmm. Which of course brings us to corsetry. Some people put corsets on their hats to get that perfect waistline. Tight lacing is not to be taken too far, or else you end up snapping in the middle, which is what happened to this lady the moment the picture was taken. A good ensemble, and you're ready to make your way off to the festival. Always make sure to bring a whip to fend off admirers or people asking to take your picture too much. It will happen, trust me. And here we have the cardinal sin, a lack of color. Hmm? All these men dressed in gray, you can't tell the difference. You need some of those loud patterns or else you kind of blend into the background too much. Hmm? So don't do this. But do this. Wear big hats and make sure to make your way to the front row of every show, because the sweetest show is the one that no one else gets to enjoy.
Thank you. Madam, how would you presenters?
Oh, do we not have time for one each?
Let's see.
Have we not done that before? You know, one if to just do a, we each do one slide of a certain presentation.
Let me see. The question is, how long have we been running? Because I'm on the free 40-minute Zoom things.
So we got 5 minutes left. Hmm? We got 5 minutes of time left.
Okay, 5 minutes.
What's the Explorer one?
That's kind of like world exploration report.
That sounds good.
Okay, we'll do explorers.
Madam, how would you like to be sitting behind?
All right, who is going to? Are we just going to go in order? Like,
let's keep the same order. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. And now, Heather, me, final group presentation, which is the annual report of the Explorers and Adventurers Society. Everyone's got their own report to make, starting with Heather.
Our membership update is that we have lots of members. Thank you.
Next slide will be Isaiah.
From the diary of Dr. Grossman, now in the third year of his cycling expedition to the North Pole, no word has been heard. Though the diary entry states that they have run out of canned hummus, and have had to start using Cheese Whiz. Grim times.
And next report comes from Carrie.
Yes, the Professor Nangala report. We still haven't found Professor Nangala. He is missing and must be retrieved before the next full moon.
Ominous.
Next report is from Russell.
Yes. The Antarctic expedition has found the Eldritch penguins, and they are actually quite easily swooned with some bagpipes. Yes. Maybe far too easily swooned.
Next report will be from Dode.
Me? Well, so we've got the North Pole and we've got the South Pole. The next trick is to wire up all the pigeons for full surveillance, so that we know what's going on at all places at all times. They are sending their reports, and well, we've seen far more than we ever hoped to.
Back to Heather again.
Oh, Sir Raymond Horatio Harrison Smythe, the 3rd Esquire, and Miss Clara Hamster upon Upton's expedition has failed. Thank you.
Quite astonishingly.
And Isaiah.
In conclusion, how do we know this isn't the right way to be looking at things? Hmm? This is how people in the Southern Hemisphere think life is. Who's to say they're not right? We are. They're mad people. Thank you.
Thank you all very much for coming to my not totally at all TED Talk seminar. I'm sure we all learned something useful, maybe.
Definitely.
Alright. And we wave goodbye to all of you enjoying our virtual festival today and hope to see you at our real festival someday in person. Bye!
Bye!